Okay, super. Well, thank you to those people that read out those readings this evening. Didn't they do well? Those people doing that, it was really great. And those readings have taken us on a journey. You see, the first reading was from a prophet, Isaiah. And that reading was in the Old Testament. So the Old Testament is before the birth of Jesus, and the New Testament is after the birth of Jesus. And that Old Testament reading told us of Emmanuel, God with us, that was to come. And there was lots of passages in the Old Testament, prophecies, people that had a message from God about the future that they could share. And these things came true. The next passage we read was in Matthew. And that was where Joseph had that dream and the angel came to him and also told him of Emmanuel. Mary was going to have a baby and he was going to be called Jesus. Emmanuel, God with us, taking on that journey from the Old Testament into the New Testament. The prophecies were coming true. And then in John 1:1, we learn about God being in the beginning, that actually Jesus was part of creation. So Jesus was there from the beginning with God, but he became God with flesh in Jesus Christ. Those messianic prophecies, actually, there were 333 messianic prophecies that were fulfilled in Jesus. And this is a big thing. And I'm going to try and explain this in the way of a gentleman in America called Josh McDowell. He wrote a book called Evidence That Demands a Verdict. If you like to read things with facts and figures and scientific backups and all that kind of stuff, then read his book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict. He was a lawyer that basically set to, when he went to law school, to try and discredit Jesus and the Christian faith that it wasn't true. So he got all this evidence together and actually realized on his own personal journey that for him it was true. And he's dedicated his life from then on to try and share that with other people. So I've tried to translate his explanation into something that we might understand. So I want you to imagine a space the size of England, Ireland, Northern Ireland, Scotland and Wales. And I want you to imagine that space, but times it by three. So three times that space. We're then... some of you, your eyes will light up. This is not happening. We're going to fill it with 10 P's. Okay, we're going to fill it with 10 P's. But not just lead flat. For some of my friends here, we're going to call it 2 foot. For other friends, we'll call it 600 millimetres. Or 60 centimetres, or if you're still at school. That frustrates me, but anyway, we'll talk about that another day. So, 2 foot thick. Over the whole of that space, we're going to cover it in 10 P's. Okay? And then what we're going to do, children, is we're going to mix up all of those 10 P's all over. So get like that. Mix them up. Come on, we're going to mix them all up now. We're mixing them all up. And then we're going to get one 10P, okay? We're going to put a mark on it like that. We're then going to get the 10P, and we're going to throw it. Don't worry, I'm not going to do it. Health and safety. We're going to throw it into the middle. And then we're going to send someone blindfolded. So let's say it's Grace. Grace is going to walk out across all of that space. Sorry, parents, she'd be gone for months. Oh, there, please, best Christmas present ever. So she's gone. Grace has gone for months, blindfolded, trying to find that 10p. Okay? If she found that 10p, and she's only allowed to do it once, bend down in the right place at the right time and pick up that 10p, all those 10p's across England, Ireland, Scotland, Wales, times that space by 3, 2 foot thick, that would be the same as Jesus fulfilling 8 messianic prophecies. 8. Jesus fulfilled 333. So it's absolutely incredible. See, Jesus came to turn things on his head. Jesus didn't come here to start another religion. Jesus came here to challenge us, to say, do you know what? It's not about what's on the outside. It's about what's on the inside. You don't need to do these Old Testament sacrifices anymore. We read on The Greatest Journey, that booklet, we read about Mary and Joseph's journey, didn't we? That they went through to have baby Jesus. The shepherds. Did you know that it's likely that those shepherds were rearing sheep on the hills that would have had lambs that would have gone to Jerusalem as sacrifices? They were still in that sacrificial system trying to find their way to God. Maybe sometimes we think we need to do good things to get to God, but the truth is that God, through Jesus Christ, has come down to us. wise men, the Magi, they travelled miles, hundreds of miles to try and find Jesus. Would we travel hundreds of miles to find Jesus? Or are we waiting for him to come to us? And if you are, then he has already come to us. Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God with us. So it's not what's on the outside, Jesus said. It's what's on the inside. And we can only have a right relationship with God if we actually go through Jesus Christ. He said, there's no way to the Father except through me. It's what's on the inside. That love, joy, hope, peace, patience, kindness, all these attributes we get when we put our faith and our trust in Jesus. But God, he can do something. He can change us on the inside. This next story is true. It is completely true, and it is completely bonkers, but it's true. In 2002, I went to Reading Music Festival with my mate Martin. And I went over to his house to pick him up. We've been planning this for months. So I went on over to his house to pick him up. He opened the door, and he came to the door, and he had the biggest coat that I've seen in a long time. It was August. He had this big, thick coat on. And I said, are you ready to go, Martin? I'm ready to go, Tim. And he came up to the door, and he had a bag bigger than this. It was full of stuff for the festival. I said, wow, this guy is prepared. And this is true. He had a water carrier bigger than this. I mean, it was absolutely huge. It's like it was the size of something you'd use on a farm. This water carrier was huge. It wasn't full of water, but Martin was prepared. It was amazing. I was so impressed. I said, wow. Well, okay, yeah, let's put it in the car. I said, right, we're going to Reading. I said, you have the map. I'll drive. It was only when we got there that we realised that Martin couldn't read a map. I think we went via Exeter to get to Reading. It took us about 5.5 hours. It's true. When we got there, we were some of the last ones there on the Friday night. Lots of people had put up their tents already. We had to walk to the far ends of the fields to put up our tent. We got to this very small space that we could put up our tent. And I said, right, Martin, we've got to get on. I can hear some bands playing in the background. You put your tent there. I'm going to put my tent there. Oh, yeah, Tim, yeah, fine. Right, so I'm putting up my tent. I'm going as quickly as I can. Are you right, Martin? Yeah, I'm really sorry, Tim, but I forgot my tent. You forgot your tent? How can you forget? Oh, we haven't got time. This is a two-man tent. It's more of a one-man tent, but okay, will you give me a hand and then you can sleep in my tent? Oh, yeah, okay, Tim. So we put up the tent together and we put it up. Brilliant. Right, I said, right, I'm going to put my sleeping bag on the right. I said, you put your sleeping bag on the left. I said, what's the matter, Martin? I forgot my sleeping bag. Forgot your sleeping bag? So one of the most memorable festivals that I've ever been to, unfortunately, well, I did share my sleeping bag with him. We unzipped it and put it over us both for that weekend. And it's a mystery to this day. What was in the bag? Because the bag was full to the brim, but there wasn't a tent in there, and there wasn't a sleeping bag in there. The poor chap also forgot his contact lenses and couldn't see any of the bands. This is true. I had to guide him around the whole weekend because he didn't want to wear his glasses. It was a memorable time. He took the water carrier, but no water went in it. Maybe there's things in our lives that we show or have on the outside, and actually we don't need them. What we need is something on the inside. What would have been useful is if he had the right things on the inside, you know? And there's stuff, it's the things that God gives us through that relationship with him that we need on our journeys. We need that on our journeys. And I just hope that each one of us can get that through a relationship with Christ. This morning, the youngsters in Kids Zone did a film. They did a really, really good film that we'd love to show you now. A great big thank you to especially Tom Hunt and John as well for all their efforts in putting this together. And I'm hoping that this will help show you a little bit about what God can give to us on our journeys. The track in the background is very different to the track that we've already had this evening. This is Stormzy, who's like a grime gangster king. A little bit different to Capella, but it's good to have variety. So if we could play that, and then we'll just finish afterwards.
I'm blinded by your grace, by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace. I'm blinded by your Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me, Lord. Been broken, although I'm not worthy, you fix me. Now I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me. One time for the Lord, and one time for the cause, and one round of applause, one time for Fraser T. Smith from the courts. I think we got one. I stay prayed up, then I get the job done. Yeah, I'm Abigail's youth, but I'm God's son. But I'm up now, look at what God's done. No, I'm real tall, look at what God did. On the main stage, running around topless. I phone flips, then I tell him that we got this. This is God's plan, they can never stop this. Like, wait right there, could you stop my verse? You saved this kid and I'm not your first. It's not by blood, it's not by birth. But oh my God, what a God I serve.
Considering the amount of time they didn't have to prepare for that this morning, but they did well. So Stormzy has some of his music reflects some of his faith and what he believes, and maybe some of it doesn't so much, but that song certainly does. He's put his cards on the table with where he's at with what he believes as a Christian. And I've got a quote here from a critique of his work who wrote for a Christian website, and it says this: "The amount of transparency that artists are showing in their music is refreshing. When it comes to artists exploring Christian themes, we often now talk about journeys, ultimately knowing that change does not come overnight. The Christian life is a process, one which is started by the gospel becoming central to all aspects of your life. For that reason, change is one of the most important components. It's impossible to meet with Jesus and stay the same. Let's hope and pray that these artists continue to be open with their faith. They are also open to the change we are all in need of. I encourage you to explore that song if you've got time over Christmas. There's some really good lyrics in that song. So those are the things that we can get when we have that relationship with God, when we accept and invite Jesus into our lives. Emmanuel, God with us. By his spirit, he could be with us in all the situations in our lives. It was amazing, wasn't it? Those different things that they had. And we had more that they could have put up there from the Bible that tells us of the promises that God gives to us on each of our journeys. Got one final small story that I want to share with you, and then I'm going to be finishing. So earlier this year, I was working locally, and one of my customers came over the road, and he said, "Tim," he said, "I've just got my Jaguar serviced, and I'd like to give you some oil. I get it serviced, and I have these spare tubs of oil. It's like the best oil you can get for a diesel engine, and it's got Jaguar written on the bottle of oil. Would you like some?" I did make a joke. I said, "Well, if it's good enough for a Jaguar, it's probably good enough for a Transit van." He didn't quite see the joke, but he said, "Yeah, okay, I'll give you some oil." So he said, "I've taken it out of the leather pouch." If you get your Jaguar serviced, evidently, they actually give you it in a leather pouch each time. So he's got all these leather pouches. And because it's serviced with the oil anyway, he doesn't need the oil. But he gave me a tub of oil. "Well," I said, "oh, thank you very much. It's very kind of you. Brilliant. So what did I do with the oil?" I put it under my seat in the van. I thought, that's where it needs to go, under the seat. Brilliant. And when I saw some of my mates over the next following weeks, I said, "Look at this. One of my customers gave me this oil. This is like, must be a bit of money. This is brilliant. I'm keeping it under the van. Brilliant." So I had this engine oil. Awesome. Good enough for a Jaguar. 8 weeks ago, I came out of Norton, I went round, I was on my way to Yeovil, I came up onto the 303 and I started to approach the Cartgate roundabout. Now if you know about the Cartgate roundabout, you now have these yellow strips that you come up to where you go like this, as long as you're not going too fast. And I was going 60 miles an hour, you can't get faster in a transit van, as I came up to the first yellow marker. So with that, I thought it was a good time to start putting the brake on. So I put my foot on the brake paddle, and nothing happened. Nothing. I had no brakes at all. I'm not a very big frame, but I put everything I had with both feet on that brake to try and stop it, and I had nothing. Absolutely nothing. A little bit of panic started to set in, I must admit. I quickly looked in the rearview mirror, and no cars were behind me. I quickly pulled into the left-hand lane. I'm still approaching this at like 40 or 50, coming up to it. As I approached the roundabout, I was pulling the handbrake, trying to switch down the gears. It's very difficult to do when you're trying to do both at the same time and trying to put your foot on the brake if there's anything left. And I managed to get up to the roundabout in about 25 miles an hour. There's no cars going around that roundabout. I zipped round and came up to Ash and I just stopped. Had a bit of a sweat. And I thought, what's happened? So I looked under the bonnet, couldn't see anything. I managed to get my van into Yeovil, and my mechanic, bless him, said, "Look, I'll get this fixed today, and we'll have a look at it, and we'll try and get it fixed today." Bless him, he stayed till 8 o'clock at night, managed to get that ready so I could have it for work the next day. He said, Tim, "I've been a mechanic for 25, nearly 30 years, and I've never seen this happen." He said, "The component that basically runs part of the system for your brakes had shattered. It had absolutely exploded into bits." He said, "It's a catastrophic failure." He said, "I've never seen this happen in the part." Well, my first thought is, right, that's it. I'm never buying a Ford again. I'm going to have to phone Ford. I'm going to have to write a letter. I'm going to have to tell everyone never to buy Ford again. It's a load of rubbish. I said, "Oh, this is no good. This is rubbish. Oh, dear, this is awful." He said, "Well, I'm going to have to stop you a minute." He said, "I think it might have been your fault." I said, "Well, what do you mean it's my fault?" I said, "This thing's blown up, it's smashed to bits. Well, he said, when I was putting the bolts in to connect the new part, I thought I needed a bit of oil to go around the bolts. So I got the dipstick. Anyway, he said, I got the dipstick into the engine oil, and I realised that actually there wasn't any there. He said, and that part needs engine oil in order to lubricate itself. Part of the braking system is linked to actually the main engine oil of the vehicle on the transit van. Well, I didn't know that. Now, I didn't obviously open my mouth and say, oh, yeah, I got some engine oil, I didn't use it, because that would obviously come across that I was a bit of a dipstick. Only my friends know that. So it was a bit embarrassing, and I think since then I've reflected that actually, in absolute honesty, that mistake could have cost me my life. That could have been dangerous for other people potentially as well, but that was a mistake. Not checking that oil and the stupidness of it, that I already had some of the best oil that I could have had sat under me. It needs to go in the engine. Maybe this evening, maybe part of our journey is sometimes to realise that actually we've been given the best gift of all for all of our lives in the form of Jesus Christ, that we can have a way to have a relationship with God, that we can journey with Jesus every single day of our lives. Maybe you're going through difficult things in your journey at the moment. Maybe it's ill health. Maybe it's looking after others with ill health. Maybe it's aspects of your job. Maybe it's aspects of friends or family or other things that are happening in your life that you are just getting frustrated with or unhappy about, or you just need some more help, and Jesus is willing to give you that help, and he will help you through other people as well. But remember that he's there for you. Remember that he's there by your side, and call out to him in those situations and see how he helps you on your journey. Because this story is the greatest journey of how God came from heaven to earth, and he wants you to join, and me to join him on that journey from now into eternity. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just thank you that we can journey in all of our lives with you. Whatever we're going through, you can journey with us. Whatever we've got to face this Christmas, you can journey with us. I do lift up those that are suffering with illness this Christmas, those that are grieving this Christmas, those that are concerned about their job this Christmas, those that have relationships that are broken, may they be restored. Those people that have worries and concerns, may they bring them to you. And ultimately, Heavenly Father, may more of us go on the greatest journey of our lives with you, and may we acknowledge you in all the areas of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.